What's up, guys? How you doing? This is Pablo from Eggheads Entertainment, bringing you another episode of Eggheads Entertainment Podcast. I wanted to bring you this special episode with a guest who I speak to almost every day regarding the superhero film industry, the TV, and comic books, something that I'm not well-versed in terms of the comic books. This gentleman that I had on the show is... been reading comic books all his life, and usually I find myself just listening to him and him telling me the stories of how he read certain comic books that were horrible due to the writer, and he just gives me a lot of history regarding characters and storylines and companies like DC, Image, and Marvel. So I wanted to bring you this episode so you guys can listen and perhaps learn something. I don't know. But I just want to say that we're trying to bring you as much content as we possibly can. It's very difficult. You know, Tracy and I work a lot, and we have other responsibilities. And so it's very difficult sometimes to bring you consistent content. And it's something that we wish to do. I mean, we wish you can do this all day, every day, but it's very difficult, especially, you know, after we record, then we have to edit it down. So that takes time. It's just time consuming, and it's very difficult. But for those of you who are stuck in there and continue to listen to our shows and watch our shows, we thank you. I hope you, on behalf of Tracy and myself, we thank you, and Freddie, and we thank you for continuing to listen, to share, and to subscribe if you haven't, and hit the notification bell so that when we do post something, you guys can get notified of that, and you can listen or watch depending on what sort of content we put up. Just to let you guys know that for this episode, I'm going to probably cut it up into pieces because it's rather long, and I know people's attention span is usually kind of short, so I just want to, you know, break them up into pieces. So just know so that for the next subsequent episodes of this podcast, my audio was a little bit bad because I did not know the mic settings. I thought I tested it. And I thought that was just the sound until he came on. I didn't test his audio, and he sounded great, but I sounded like I was off a little bit, so I apologize for that. But they will get better. We're learning every day to improve our show for you guys, for ourselves, because we are very proud of what we do. So without further ado, here's my conversation with Mr. Alex Bernstein. Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Eggheads Entertainment Podcast. This is your boy, Pablo. Unfortunately, Mr. Tracy Spivey is not here today, but he will join us, I'm pretty sure, for the next show. And he's going to be upset because today we have a guest. And this is a guest that we've been trying to get on the show for quite some time. And I finally made it happen. So I'm really excited to have this conversation. This man is a stand-up comic. He's a writer. He's written for Disney, HBO, and McSweeney's. And was reviews editor for years for the legendary comic book pop culture website Pop Image. He's the author of Plurknib and Miserable Adventure Stories. And you can see all this stuff on PromOnMars.com. I'd like to welcome Mr. Alex Bernstein.
Hey, Pablo.
How you doing, man?
Good. How are you?
I'm good.
You said Plurknib, right?
Yeah, because I heard it the first time.
Yeah.
First of all,
sure.
You've written for Disney and HBO.
Yeah.
How did you get those gigs?
Well, the Disney one's recent. I wrote for this cartoon, Peking Duckling, okay, a couple years ago. And a great show, a phenomenal show. It's like a SpongeBob for preschoolers. And The guy who I was working with, I don't think is producing the show anymore, but he's got a fabulous company and he produces all this stuff for preschool. The HBO was decades ago, but I get to say I wrote for HBO. So,
any show we would know?
It was some sketch comedy show back like in the 90s when before like right when Comedy Central was launching and stuff. Okay. And so they did a bunch of sketch stuff and I wrote this monologue Gypsy, which was used in all these auditions for every woman basically had to read this monologue. So
before we get started, I always have to start off with anybody I speak to in regards to Infinity Wars. What did you think about it?
I loved it. I thought it was excellent. No Adam Warlock, so that's not a great thing. Yeah. But it was a little busy for me. I thought it's one of those movies where I actually enjoy it more now, like a couple of weeks later, than I did at the time. At the time, I thought it was kind of manic and frantic, too many heroes without a cohesive narrative structure. But I think that, once I got away from it and I started thinking about, Doctor Strange and Spider-Man and everybody on the streets fighting the one children of Thanos and all that stuff. I just think the mechanics of that scene were great. And I love Josh Brolin's Thanos. Mm-hmm. And I love all the questions about what the end could have been. Okay. So I think it could have been narratively a stronger film, especially coming off of Black Panther. Mm-hmm. But I think in terms of it being this big blowout, it certainly, was successful as a big blowout. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I was happy with the pacing because you got this guy coming to kill off half of the world and you got to stop him. I would expect it to be a little bit manic and crazy.
Yeah.
I could have done a little bit without the humor.
Yeah.
As well as I'm getting pretty tired of it and I'm pretty sure we're going to see it for Avengers 4 because obviously they're going to be going back in time, obviously, to the first time. I guess that army that Loki sent, we'll see that again because I believe they're going back in time. And it's, I can do without the constant Avengers fighting army.
Yeah, absolutely. And I could have done without the Forge and, as much as I like Peter Dinklage, I could have done without the let's go create a weapon that can kill him. I think, in a way, I think it almost functions less to me as a here, go see this movie, is almost this like massive conversation piece for people to talk about. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was like at brunch on Mother's Day and like the table next to us, they're all talking about it like 2 weeks later. And I think that, it's just become this more of a cultural, that's all we're talking about in bars and restaurants. And everybody has an opinion on what's going to happen at the end, as opposed to, I just saw Citizen Kane and, here's what happened to Charles Foster Kane.
Is it a similar feeling like when Star Wars came out, where people were talking about it and it was...
I think it's more of Star Wars now than it was the first trilogy. I think that the great thing about, again, about movies like Black Panther and about the first Guardians and the Winter Soldier are that, you're getting something you haven't seen before. I mean,
did you ever think, like reading Infinity Wars, that you would see a movie about this?
No. I've been reading comics for my entire life. And I'm in my 50s, dude.
Yeah, I'm coming to talk to this guy.
And when I was a kid, I had to like go, not literally in the closet, but I mean, you couldn't walk around telling people, oh, I'm reading Adam Warlock. And I mean, I read Adam Warlock the first time. I read Marvel 2-in-1 Annual was it Marvel 2-in-1 Annual? No, it was Avengers Annual and Marvel Team-Up Annual where Warlock first, the Infinity Stones first come out and the Avengers team up with Warlock and Spider-Man and the Thing to fight Thanos. And it was mind-blowing. I mean, it was really... But it wasn't something you went to school and you were like, hey, everybody. It was like, I don't want to tell anybody that I did this. And so to see people in restaurants talking about it now, I'm like, oh, my God. Or even when Doctor Strange came out, I was like, oh, my God.
I think he was definitely one of the MVPs of this movie. Doctor Strange I enjoyed, but to me it felt like the same formula as Iron Man, the same sort of personality. So it felt familiar. It wasn't an escape to Doctor Strange.
Right. I just mean the concept that they made a Doctor Strange movie that wasn't like on TV with the guy with the mustache and stuff. I mean, even the Iron Man, the first Iron Man movie, because when he came out, I mean, Iron Man, no offense to Iron Man, but I mean, he was sort of a C-list character when that movie was made. And I mean, the Guardians of the Galaxy are like Z-list. So it's interesting to see Thanos and all these guys get together and it become something that everybody is suddenly aware of. But where the hell is Adam Warlock?
I wish they would have done it, but I see the difficulty in introducing a character like that.
Yeah, I do too.
Do you think New Gods will be a film that people will like, will be enthusiastic about, excited about?
I don't think it's a good move for DC on a bunch of levels. And I think that this is probably the mistake that DC is making in general. But I think that it's a big idea. I think that it's a big concept, and they've already introduced Steppenwolf, and they've already hinted at the New Gods, and even in the cartoons they've hinted at the New Gods, and you know, they want Darkseid of the New Gods to be their big bad. And I mean, Thanos was based once upon a time on Darkseid.
So it's crazy how it's universal.
Yeah, crazy. Well, and I mean, even with Steppenwolf in the Justice League movie, which I didn't hate, and I didn't hate the Green Lantern movie, but I think they're a mistake because I think that anytime that DC is doing something that's a reaction to Marvel is a bad idea. And I think that the biggest problem I had with all of the Justice League movie was that, well, I like that Steppenwolf is in and of itself a big bad. He just has no character. And to make the Mother Boxes the Infinity Gems, because the Mother Boxes are the MacGuffin in Justice League, I just think, you know, you're going to the same well. But the real problem I have with the New Gods is that I think that in the comics, and the movies are going to follow this because they have been, have never really been developed to the point where there is a solid narrative core. And I'll tell you what I mean by that, because I thought a lot about it this morning. So, you know, what you have is you have all these 1970s ideas from Jack Kirby, right? When Jack Kirby comes to DC, and he just explodes, right? With all these just great ideas. The biggest, of course, is the New Gods, but he also has OMAC, and he has Commandy, and he has the Demon. The Demon's probably the most developed of any of those. And they're just phenomenal ideas. And they last in total a couple of years. They last maybe a few years. Commandy goes the farthest and is actually a pretty great thing. And I loved OMAC. And I actually love the New Gods. But the thing that happens after they leave, after he leaves, after Kirby leaves, is that just for the next X decades, just nobody knows what to do with these folks. I'm sure people will argue with me against that. They're great ideas, but nobody just ever takes them anywhere that Jack Kirby didn't take them in the beginning. And I'll give you the best two examples I have of how Marvel doesn't do that, right? So Marvel has two ideas also come for the most part from Kirby, right? Which are the Fantastic Four and Thor, right? Mm-hmm. Thor to me should be just the most D-list character. He's not an original character. He's based on mythology. He speaks the way he speaks. Mm-hmm. And when Stan Lee brings him out with Kirby, they're fighting the Stone Men from Venus or whatever they're fighting. It's just a character that on page should not last beyond 20 issues. Mm-hmm. It's Marvel in the early days, so he goes 100 issues. Should have died after 100 issues at best, right? Mm-hmm. But then what you do is the way you have it with Thor, with Daredevil, with almost every great Marvel character, is somebody comes along and goes, I'm going to evolve this. I'm going to dig deeper and I'm going to find out what the story is here. And takes, you know, it says Kirby lays this tapestry. I'm going to find out my take on it. And so you have Walt Simonson who does that with Thor in the 80s, right? And does just a brilliant job. And suddenly it's just this deep thing. But then you see all these other runs of Thor, and some of them don't work. But now you've got Jason Aaron in the last few years, who just, I think, did an even better job with Walt Simonson. And you have this D-list character who suddenly, this incredibly vital character in it, in the mythology of its play, and he builds his own mythology out of it. And then the movies take that stuff, and they don't necessarily take on what Jason Aaron's doing, although I think you could argue that they took on some of what Simonson did. Same with Daredevil. You have Frank Miller come in, and he did that with Batman too. I mean, he gives these guys really super strong backstories, and people have done that. Most of the Marvel characters, people have done that. People have done that at DC too. They've done that. They've certainly done that with Superman, and they've done that with Batman. I've never seen them do it ever with any of Kirby's DC work. And it's a shame because the New Gods have the potential to be something, but you really don't have, there's just a blank slate, really, to this day of the New Gods. And there's some powerful ideas there, but, you know, I think that's why Steppenwolf in the movie and why the Mother Boxes kind of left everybody cold. I mean, Thanos, as an example, you know, love him or hate him, you've just got decades of these Jim Starlin comics telling you about Thanos. And that scene where Thanos ends up in this field and the soul gem and all that stuff, that's straight out of the comics. And I remember when that happened in the comics and people were like, holy crap. And you've just never had that moment with the New Gods. And I think that if you're going to do, and I also think it's why the DC cartoons tend to be more successful than the movies, because the cartoons are doing that. They're taking... They're taking the best stories. And I don't think there's a best New Gods story. And so I think that that's why it's going to fall apart. I mean, DC's got great, great, deep well of stories. I just think they're not picking the right ones. If I was DC, you know, and I like Geoff Johns. I think Geoff Johns has some real feel for the character. He's written some great stories. He's not my absolute favorite DC writer, but he's a guy that understands the mythos of DC. He's done some great things with Hawkman.
Do you think, I tend to believe that they have had the conversation and nobody's made mention of it. Do you think they haven't approached Bruce Timm?
I don't know. I wish they would. I think Bruce Timm is phenomenal. I think he and Geoff Johns get DC. And I think that they... And again, I think they put it into the cartoons. Mm-hmm. I mean, their cartoons are phenomenal.
Yeah.
And I think it's all about money. And I think that eventually they probably would go to Bruce Timm. I mean, maybe they have, and he's just, I mean, you know, there may be some people that are just like, yeah, I don't want to go near that. You know, I think there's tons of people. Patton Oswalt could probably come in and fix it.
Yeah, so that was part one of this conversation with Mr. Alex Bernstein. We discussed Infinity Wars and the New Gods movie that DC's working on. In part two, we will be discussing Deadpool. Ben Affleck's decision to want to return as the Caped Crusader. So that should be a good conversation. Thank you again for listening. I will try to have the second part up as soon as possible. Thank you once again. Please subscribe. Please comment. Definitely would love to hear from you guys to see what you think. And let's start up a conversation. If there's anything you want us to discuss, we will discuss it. We're here to talk and give you guys our opinions. And, you know, cause one of the things that makes this fun for us is that we enjoy certain things. And sometimes is not that it's difficult, but... to find someone else who enjoys the same thing and you can talk about it and give your opinion, and the person may not agree with you, and you can sort of not necessarily have a debate, but certainly have a discussion about the subject, about the film, about certain ideas, and it's usually a fun time. So we welcome you to engage in the comment section below, subscribe, again, hit that notification button, as well as share it with other people that you may know. Once again, thank you very much, and we will see you soon. Thank you.